how he labels these disciples.
Wow.
Oh, perverse and unbelieving generation, how long shall I? He is not pleased. The Bible says that without faith, it's impossible to please him. Anyone who comes to him must believe that he exists, that he rewards those who diligently seek him.
Yeah.
Amen?
Yeah.
So, you know, a church that without faith is not going to be around long.
Amen.
You know, we don't know when our time is up. That's we're right. not going to operate in true faith
Amen.
And see miracles happen.
That's right. That's right.
You might say, how long am I going to put up with you guys?
Hmm. Yeah.
We don't want him to say that, do we?
No.
We want him to say, oh, I haven't seen such great faith
right.
in all of Texas. Amen.
Amen.
Wouldn't that be awesome?
Amen.
That we would be that pleasing to him. I want him, we're going to close with that prayer in just a minute. That he will say of us,
Amen.
These people have great faith.
Amen.
I haven't seen faith like that all over Fort Worth. Amen.
Amen.
Praise God. Praise God. So I think the bottom line, or one of the bottom lines, is God intends for miracles to happen.
Amen.
Jesus said, I only do what I see the Father doing. So he sees the Father always doing miracles. Right? He says, I only do what I see the Father doing.
That's right.
And we're going to John 14 now. So God intends for miracles. He intends for the impossibilities
Amen.
To be removed through the faith
yes.
of his people. And I want us to go to John 14. I have never had a year with this much ragweed allergy. I've always had allergies, but I think this is one of the worst years. So if you guys can put up with me and noise. Okay, so John 14:9 says, don't you know me, Philip, even after I've been among you for such a long time? Anyone who has seen me has seen the Father. How can you say, show us the Father? Don't you believe that I am in the Father and the Father is in me? The words I say to you, they're not just my own. There's the Father living in me who is doing his work. And so that's another scripture that says that it wasn't Jesus operating out of his divinity as the second person of the Trinity, but through the Spirit living in him. Who is the Spirit that lives in him? The Spirit, God's Spirit.
Mm-hmm.
Right? The Spirit of Christ, God's Spirit too. So that verse 10, don't you believe that I am in the Father and that the Father is in me? The words I say to you, they're not my own, rather it's the Father. So he didn't speak of his own words. He didn't work miracles out of his own divine power. What that ultimately means for us is so off the charts amazing that we won't go into a lot tonight. But he says, the words I say to you, they're not my own. They're not just my own. Rather, it is the Father living in me who is doing his work. Believe me when I say that I am in the Father and the Father's in me, or at least believe on the evidence of the miracles themselves.
Yeah.
I tell you the truth, anyone who has faith in me will do what I have been doing.
Yeah.
You know, that's pretty comprehensive. What do y'all think?
Amen.
Anyone who has faith in me, and he says, I tell you the truth, or he preceded it with, in King James, it's verily, verily. He precedes it with like a double oath. I tell you the truth. Anyone who has faith in me will do what I have been doing. He will do even greater things than these because I'm going to the Father. He will do even greater things because why do we do greater things? Because he went to the Father. We'll see in a minute. And I will do whatever you ask in my name so that the Son may bring glory to the Father. The reason we will do greater works than he is because the Father receives glory, more glory, than even when Jesus did it himself. Because Jesus had an advantage as far as faith was concerned, right?
Amen.
He was sinless. He was, I mean, he had every advantage over us, but he laid down the advantage of operating out of his own divinity, but he operated out of the divinity of the Holy Spirit, who was the Father in him, right? Kind of hard to figure that out. But he said, and I will do whatever you ask in my name.
Amen.
So, see, it brings great glory to God for us to petition the Father. I mean, to petition Christ.
Yes.
Because God, who sent Christ? Who offered up Christ?
God,
the Father.
Jesus.
And when the world knows that Christ is the Messiah, right? Right? He's the hope of the world.
Right.
He's the way, the truth, and the life. That brings great glory to the Father.
Amen.
See, Philip up above said, Lord, show us the Father. He said, don't you know, Philip? Anyone who's seen me has seen the Father.
Yeah.
See, there's so many religions that believe in God, but they don't believe in Jesus.
Yeah.
So just what we believe brings glory to God.
Amen.
But then how we operate in faith.
Wow.
When we don't have all the advantages. We were born in sin.
Yes.
Right? We're fallen creatures. Renewed, restored, redeemed through the blood of Christ. But when we operate in the faith of Christ through the Holy Spirit, that brings glory to the Father. And then he just says it again. You may ask me for anything in my name, and I will do it. So that takes faith to believe just what the scripture says.
Amen.
And to operate it, doesn't it?
Amen.
But he so wants us to operate that way. I mean, it brings glory to him. Oh, my goodness. It brings glory to God. Instead of us being a perverse and whatever generation, oh, that we bring great glory to the Father because we come to the Son.
Amen.
And asking for him to do greater works in us. It's already a promise. You can ask for anything that's been promised, and the assurance that it will happen is 100%. Because God is faithful to his promises.
Amen.
Yeah.
But somehow we've got to get this, what were the words, the perverse and what? Unbelieving. We got to deal with unbelief. You know, the man said, I believe, help my unbelief. See, when we have trouble believing, that's a problem. It's as much problem as a sin, probably. I guess it is the sin of unbelief.
Yeah.
Calls it sin.
Wow.
So, you know, if I was standing here talking about something that was optional, you would say, well, that was kind of sweet. Let's go home and go about life as we did yesterday or, you know, today. But no, we can't.
Mm-mm.
Because the light is shined or shown on a truth. That we can't disregard anymore.
Amen.
Christ is not here in the flesh. We are his flesh today. And the works that are done today are done through us, through his people. There are people on this earth that God is working amazing miracles through, especially in third world countries.
Amen.
Not as much in America. God lives in us by his Spirit, just as he did in Christ. And God wants glory for himself through us.
Amen.
Amen. We got a call one time a few years ago about a young woman up in Baylor Hospital in Fort Worth that she was dying and that they were already planning the funeral. And they were mainly just wanting us to help with the funeral.
Mm-hmm.
But Brandy went up there first, and she put posters all over the walls of this room. This girl was dying of liver disease from alcoholism. And they called us, they said her liver was shutting down or had already shut down. And so we prayed for her healing.
Mm-hmm.
We prayed that there would be a healing instead of a funeral.
Mm-hmm.
And guess what? She was healed.
Yes.
She was in May's. How many know May?
Williams.
Huh?
Williams.
May Williams' sister's daughter named Diane.
Right.
Very soon she went home.
Mm-hmm.
It was so remarkable as far as the hospital was concerned. Somebody better pray for you.
Yes.
The word spread all over the hospital.
Yes.
And they said they wanted us to come and pray over everybody in the hospital. Well, you realize that when Jesus came, if there was a hospital, it would have been empty.
Yeah.
And wouldn't it be something today to have some people go into a hospital and just empty it out?
Yeah.
Hallelujah!
Amen. Jesus said, greater works you will do.
Amen.
Than I do, because I'm going to the Father, and I'm going to speed the process up, because you're going to pray to me, and I'm going to pray to the Father, and because it's me, he's going to honor me, and then I'm going to bring glory to him, and you're going to bring, it's a big deal here. It's the best thing going in the whole world right now, what God wants to do.
Yes, it is.
He's not short on miracles.
No, he's not. Mm-mm.
You know, I kind of went in my shell because this girl never walked in the door of a church. She's
right.
Still alive.
Mm-hmm.
But she never walked in the door of a church, and I just got kind of angry.
Yeah.
I said, I'm not going to pray for anybody else. They don't even give God any glory. But that's not our responsibility. Amen?
Right. Right.
Jesus said, at least believe on the evidence of the miracles themselves.
Right. Wow. That's
Amen.
True.
So people, miracles, you know, give people opportunities to believe that they didn't have.
That's right.
Amen. That's right.
If we don't do what needs to be done, God will be deprived of great glory. Jesus will be deprived of great glory, and our church will stay small. Right?
That's right.
I want to actually have one more scripture. It's Mark 16.
Mark 16.
Two or three verses, and then we're done. Two or three verses. It starts with verse 17. It says in verse 17, these signs, Mark 16, verse 17, these signs will accompany those who believe. In my name, they will drive out demons.
Amen.
He's talking about everyone who believes.
Yeah.
Every believer will drive out demons.
Yeah.
Mark 16:17. In my name, they will speak in new tongues. They will pick up snakes with their hands. Oh, Lord, I don't want to do that. When they drink deadly poison, it will not hurt them at all. They will place their hands on sick people, and they will get well.
Hallelujah.
And the Lord Jesus had spoken to them. He was taken up into heaven, and he sat at the right hand of God, the place of power, the place of authority. And then the disciples went out and preached everywhere. And the Lord worked with them and confirmed his word by the signs that accompanied it. You can read about all that in Acts.
Amen.
All the
Amen.
That just happened constantly.
Amen.
We prayed a couple weeks ago for my neighbor who had really bad COPD, and she couldn't go to work, but she By the next day, she was a lot better, and she's back at work. Several people in my neighborhood are back in church. I've had 11 in my Bible, altogether in my Bible study.
Praise God.
I've met 90 families.
Praise God.
I had a request for a second Bible study time.
Praise the Lord.
It doesn't matter what area of ministry that we're talking
about. No, no, no.
It doesn't. We just have faith.
Yes.
And for some reason, when I'm meditating on Mark 8, this faith started rising up in me.
Amen.
Where it said, remember? Remember when we talked about the storm?
Yes.
When the Lord spoke that to me, I've been meditating on that every day. And I have got this, just this burst of faith that I just, things that just seem to be impossible just don't seem to be hard at all. Mm-hmm. As I think about. See, our thinking has got to change, right?
Amen.
So, praise God, I forgot where it was even at.
Yeah.
But I'm just saying that let the Holy Spirit lead you to what to focus on.
Amen. Amen.
And got to get out of the games and out of the TV and out of whatever it is that would keep our focus. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. We can't let other stuff rob us of time to nurture our faith.
Amen.
Letting the Holy Spirit, God wants to do way more than we can even imagine. That's what it says in Ephesians.
Yes.
He's able to do exceeding abundantly above
all we can ask or imagine.
Or even imagine. So